The Revelation of the Book Revelation, Part 27. I'm Professor Hannes Redinghuis of the First Assembly of Yahushua in South Africa, Pretoria, Montana. Should you be interested in any of the books which I've written, or maybe the restoration of the original Sacred Name Bible, the Rottenham version, please contact us at 0722-367-124. That's a plus 27 international code. Or just go to my website, https://yahvah.co.za. If this is the first time that you will participate in our study, I urge you to go to part one and start from the beginning, because you have missed quite a bit of information up till now. It's also very, very important to subscribe to the channel, so in order to receive the notifications of all the other studies that we are currently busy with. It's also necessary to send the link to your friends and family, everyone that you would like to participate or share the study with. Make sure that you have a Bible, at least a 1611 King James Bible, pen and paper ready to make notes. It's important to know that we do not associate ourselves with the following people: any Messianic groups, the Israel Vision groups, the Hebrew Roots movement, the Sacred Name movement, the Yah movement. We are not part of the Jehovah Witness or Seventh-day Adventist church. Instead, we are not affiliated to any church, denominational organization in the world. We are only an end-time Bible study group functioning throughout the world. We are mainly using the ancient original Hebrew Sacred Name Bible, according to the 1860 restoration of the original Sacred Name Bible, the Rottenham version, which was translated by Dr. Joseph Briand Rottenham, which is one of the oldest English/Hebrew Bibles you will lay your hands on, which I have a couple of copies available should you be interested. According to the ancient Hebrew Sacred Name Bible, the restoration of the original Sacred Name Bible, the 1860 version, the name Jesus was originally Yahushua. The name God was originally Elohim Hashim. The name Lord was originally Yahweh. The name of the Holy Spirit was originally the Ruach HaKodesh. We refer to ourselves as Yahvists, according to 1 Peter 4 verse 16 in the restoration of the original Sacred Name Bible. So were the disciples and the apostles and the followers of Yahushua. They did in about 2,000 years ago. I trust that this study is going to be a blessing unto you in the wonderful name of Yahushua. Hallelujah. We are going to continue where we left off last week. The next name the Roman Catholic Church will change was the ancient Hebrew name Elohim. Listen to the name Elohim. The Hebrew name Elohim was a name the Orthodox Jews knew Yahweh Almighty by. They, the ordinary Jews, never called Yahweh by his name. They referred to him as Elohim of Hashem, but never as Adonai. Adonai is the modern Hebrew. Only the high priest once a year, when sacrificing the blood of animals in the temple for the atonement of the sins, will use the name Yahweh, Y-A-H-V-A-H. In Hebrew, from right to left, Yod, Aleph, Hei, Fof, Aleph, Hei. When he will rub the blood on the of the animals, on the wings of the cherubs in the Ark of the Covenant. In the second century, the Roman Catholic Church will change the ancient Hebrew name Elohim to Kyrios or Theos between 100 and 127 AY, which is referring to Nimrod, the sun god. Zeus or Ras or Ra. The word God in Greek only means object of worship. There's no special name referring to God. Like I said before, this camera is a Siemens camera. You can call him God, means an object of worship. The word God is a Greek word meaning object of worship. Any tree, stone, animal can be your God. That means he's your object of worship. The word God is not the name of Yahweh Almighty. You must listen to it. When you use the word God, you're not addressing the name of God. I'm using the word God to explain here. When using the word God, you're not referring specifically to Yahweh Almighty. It can be any God. And most Protestant and charismatic churches claims to be. Most of the Protestant charismatic churches in the last 600 years have never discovered the original sacred Hebrew name of their Elohim. How sad. They just call him God or Lord or Yahweh, Jehovah. What do you want to call him? There was no letter J's. So how can you call him Jehovah with a J? The next original ancient Hebrew name the Roman Catholic will change was the name of the Ruach HaKodesh. This name means the breath of Yahweh El Elohim. What does the Ruach HaKodesh mean? The breath of Yahweh El Elohim. In the Roman Catholic Church changed the name Ruach HaKodesh to the name Holy Spirit, as it is known today in English. It is not my intention to confuse you, but according to the original ancient Hebrew text, the Torah, the scriptures and the prophets, the restoration of the original sacred name Bible, the Rosenum version, is proof of how the Roman Catholic Church corrupt many Hebrew and Greek texts and many scripts over a period of 2,000 years. Today, I don't know whether you know, there's 5,333 Greek texts. So when you're talking Greek or you're addressing Greek, the subject, which manuscript are you using? When mentioning Hebrew, which alphabet are you using? 258 modern Hebrew script alphabets between 22 and 27 letters. All depends which one you're using. It is because any name change alters the character of the original name. When you change somebody's name, you're actually trying to change his character. Therefore, King Nebuchadnezzar changed the names of the Hebrew men for the benefit of the Babylonian kingdom, unto whom the prince of the Icarus gave names, for he gave Daniel the name of Belshazzar, and Ananiah he called Shadrach, and to Mishael he called Meshach, and Azariah he called Abednego. In the next part of our study, we'll find that Daniel will not define himself eating and drinking from the king's table. But Daniel proposed that his heart that he will not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. What happened? Daniel refused to partake whatever the king ate or drink. And I tell you what, there's more to this than only that Daniel didn't want to partake of the table of the king. Daniel refused to partake of the table of the king because most of the time the king will eat of pagan offerings. That was incense, that was burned as incense. It was holy meat to them. Pagan offerings unto different pagan gods. And Daniel didn't just want to say, no, I don't want to eat the king's food. He wouldn't touch anything that was offered or slaughtered or sacrificed to any pagan god. Zeus, Nimrod, Isis. He would just not touch it. Why? Because he would not defile his body with it. And not only his body, but also his soul's dimension, which is his mind. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the encouraged that he might not define himself. We need to remember that Daniel lived according to the 613 laws of Moses and never defiled himself by eating pagan foods. Even if it comes from the king's table, Daniel was not prepared to make any compensation whatsoever. You're not to make any compromises when it comes to the gospel. As part of the bride of Yahushua, we live by the standard of the word of Yahweh. We live by the anointing of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. The lesson to learn from the scripture is that under no circumstances do we take part of the bride of Yahushua need to make any compensations or compromises with the world or even with Satan. We don't make compromises. This is what's happening in the world today. There's new one world religion which is functioning under the Roman Catholic authority, the Pope. They want to compromise in every way just for the sake of being one religion. This is what the devil wants. Verse 9, now Yahweh Almighty had brought Daniel into favor and tended love with the prince of the Inkornesh. Now Yahweh Almighty had brought Daniel into his favor, which means that Daniel was loved by the Babylonians. Why? Because he had to stand. He refused to partake in any pagan rituals. We know now that King Nebuchadnezzar besieged the city of Jerusalem. This is a city where Daniel and his friends grew up. Daniel and his three friends were totally dedicated to the Hebrew religion. They grew up in the Hebrew religion. As young men, they feared Yahweh Almighty and served him with their lives and all their possessions. We'll find that Daniel and his three friends stood head and shoulders above the rest of the other Hebrew children. They were well-built to be taken note of. The word of Yahweh Almighty mentioned that Daniel was steadfast and good-looking. We read that the king commanded his servants that all the young men should eat from the king's table. Daniel and his three friends refused to eat from the king's table. Again, why? Because it was pagan offerings, the meat. Daniel and his three friends refused to partake and to partake in this new world religion. To Daniel and them, the Babylonian religion was a new world religion. This is what's happening today. Three Babylons. The first Babylon was in the time of Semiramis in Nimrod, Genesis 10. First Babylon. The second Babylon in the time of Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel 1, 2 and further on. The third Babylon, you will read about in Revelation 17, is this Babylon whore mother sitting on the waters. Babylonian whore mother sits, so she's got children, sitting on waters. What is she sitting on? In a boat, canoe, a piece of timber? No. If you read the Revelation 17 verse 15, he says, when you see the figurative speech of water in the book of Daniel and Revelation, it's nations and tongues and multitude of people. So what is the Roman Catholic Church doing? Because he explains that if you read Revelation 17 right through, especially between the first six verses, he says she's dressed in scarlet and purple, Roman Catholic colors. She wears jewels, which is a crucifixes and crosses. And in her right hand she has a mug full of the blood of the martyrs and the servants of Yahushua. I want to say the Yafis. Over 1,500 years, they killed more than 150 million Yahvist Jews and so-called Christians, not accepting the Roman Catholic theology and dogma. And that cost them their lives. They were killed. And that you can find in the ancient Hebrew, in the ancient history books. And that's why the book that I've written, which is also the handbook for the study, the two keys to the book of Revelation. The first key, like I explained to you, is the book Daniel. And the second key is world history books. The safe is the book Daniel. And in the safe is the greatest treasure you will ever find. But you need to have the two keys put into the locks of the safe door simultaneously. And that you can only find the treasure if you have the two people with the keys ready to open the door simultaneously. They refuse to take part of this one world order and new church system. The word of Yahweh Elohim states that Daniel and his friends only ate pulse and drank water, that they were fairer and fatter than the younger men who ate from the king's table. You know, when you walk in holiness, when you walk the straight and narrow road, when you walk in the revelation of the Ruach HaKodesh and the word of Yahweh, you will look fairer and fatter spiritually than anybody else. Why? Because Yahweh feed us with prime spiritual food. That's why we are constantly busy day by day by day in Bible study. You need, when a baby is born, you need to feed the baby 3, 4, 5, 6 times a day. In the beginning, every 2 hours. To get him strength or her strength. And the same when a new baby in the spirit is born, somebody's repent and they've been immersed. The old man of sin or woman has been buried and they arise, a new creation in Yahushua. Romans 6 verse 1 to 12, grew equal in Yahushua through his death, his burial and the resurrection. We need to be fed. These new children, these babies, they need to be fed with Bible study information daily. Otherwise, they won't make it. In 2 months to 6 months, they will just backslide. That's not what we want. When we preach the word and the gospel of Yahushua, We expect, as we are sowing the seed of life, we expect that there will be crops well taken care of by the Ruach HaKodesh. Verse 10, and the prince of the equerries says unto Daniel, I fear my... Now it says, my Lord and King. Now the word Lord has got a different meaning. Lord means master. That's all which Lord means. Lord actually means my master and my king. For many years, especially in the Afrikaans, we thought that the name Lord in Afrikaans is Here. Lord is the name of God, because we didn't know the names. But today we understand that Lord only just means master, who had appointed your meat and your drink, for thy should see your face worse king, that the children which are at your sword, they shall make me endanger my heart to the king. So what did he say to him? They were looking further, stronger than the young people that ate from the table of the king. He says in verse 12, I think, let me just read verse 11. Then said Daniel to Malzar, whom the prince of Ikrai has set over Daniel, Ananiah, Mishael, and Abazaria. Daniel now addressed the prince of the Inzarzar, in Shachs. Prove thy servants, I've seized thee 10 days, and let them give us pulse and meat and drink water. Daniel is urging the prince of the Ennesh to let them live in pulse and drink water for only 10 days. And then we will show ourselves. Then let our countenance be looked upon before thee, and the countenance of the children to eat the portion of the king's meat, and as I see, deal with our servants. This verse is explaining the same which I have just explained in the previous verse. So he consented that there is a matter improved for 10 days. Here we find that the prince of the Ennesh gave consent to Daniel and his friends. And at the end of 10 days, the court in Ennesh appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat portions of the king's meat. So what did they do? They believed that by not eating pagan food, that Yahweh would bless them. I know this is a lot of history, but we also need to understand the history. There's a lot of wonderful information also in history. If we as part of the bride of Yahshua compare ourselves with the world, now see how we bring this in to this 21st century, we shall find that we have advanced much further in the spirit, which is a Ruach HaKodesh, than any of them, the people who were lost in their sins. This we can only say by grace. Hallelujah. It's not by ourselves. We don't stand by ourselves. We don't perform by ourselves. It's grace and grace alone. And I always say that grace has a name. Did you know grace has a name? Grace is not an object. Grace has a name. Grace has personality. Grace has a living soul. Grace is a living soul. Can I explain? You know who's grace? Yahshua is grace. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? Yes. As long as we live in grace and move in grace, in Yahshua, we are more than conquerors. Yahweh foreseen in every one of our needs. Every time. There's a little chorus that we sang many years ago. He's never failed me yet. Yahshua has never failed me yet. Has he ever failed you? Even in the deepest tribulation and the greatest problems, he was there. He is there to hold us in the palms of his hands. We shall find that the following few scriptures confirm what I've already said. Thus Malzar took away the portion of the meat and the wine and they should drink, and gave them pulse. As from verse 17, as from these four children. And they were not children, they were young men. Yahweh gave them knowledge and skill and all learning and wisdom. I mean, children doesn't have knowledge and wisdom and skills, and it's young men. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now at the end of the day that the king has said he should bring them in, then the prince of the Ennesh brought them into before Nebuchadnezzar, as the king. It's important to see what is happening now. Very important. And the king commanded commute with them. And among them was found none like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Sadrach. Therefore stood they before the king. Daniel and his three friends are appearing before King Nebuchadnezzar to compare to other young people who ate from the king's table. I'm so glad we don't participate in sin. Prof, are you an angel with white wings? No. In our lives, we made a lot of mistakes. I can remember, I was an apprentice artisan. I'm a boilermaker by trade, actually. I can manufacture about anything from steel and wood as well. But I can remember that my father, the day before I start working as an apprentice, told me the moment that I walk into the factory, I need to steal. And I had a very strict father. I couldn't understand what he was saying. And I said, but you taught me my whole life I should not touch nothing of nobody. He said, steal with your ears and your eyes. What you steal with your eyes and your ears, nobody can put you in jail for. And this is what we are supposed to do in this life. As part of the bride of Yahshua, we need to observe every day. Not once a day, once a week, once a month. As long as we are striving towards perfection, we are not perfect. Not yet. We're trying to be. As long as we are striving towards perfection through the Ruach HaKodesh. Why? Because we've been redeemed by the blood of Yahshua. Does this mean that you'd never sin again, you never make a mistake? No. The Bible says all have sinned. All have sinned. But you know what? We've been washed in the blood of Yahshua. We've been redeemed by His blood. And now we need to stay faithful in holiness. Living in holiness every day of our lives. Striving in faith. And seeking any opportunity where we can have a chance to sow the seed of life into the lives of others. So we need to steal with our eyes and our ears, meaning we need to observe. And when we observe the end time prophecies and the happenings in the world, the things happening around us, we notice every day more and more and more the secular world is trying to push the world into a corner, to manipulate our minds and our deeds, your finances, your business, your house. Everything, mind control, crowd control. I mean, if you take the schools today, look at the schools. It's totally the opposite of what it was when we were youngsters. Today, there's hardly any discipline in schools. The moment that a teacher becomes disciplined and react when students doesn't do what they're supposed to do, then they get charged. They bring charges against him to such an extent that it can even cost him his job. So what do? There's an English saying, they just go with the flow. We, as part of the bride of Yahushua, we refuse. I refuse to go with the flow. If it's not according to the standard of the scripture, at least the 1611 King James Bible, in our case, we use the restoration of the original Sacred Name Bible, the best English Hebrew stroke Hebrew English Bible you will ever find. Sorry, I've got a little hair in my nose that's aggravating me. So we live in holiness, observing. We don't need to partake in the sins of the world. And that's why when you become a Yafis, you're not very popular. Because your friends and your family, they want you to do what you used to do. And times has changed in the sense that we live by faith. We walk by faith. We talk faith. We live in the revelation word. And we want to be an example to anybody outside. So what happened to Daniel and his friends? They refused to partake of the pagan offerings and not eat and drink from the king's table. In this week coming, I want you to think about this word. When certain situations occur, where you need to partake in earthly doings, think about Daniel. Yahweh says he will guide and lead you. He will keep you right to the end. Time has caught up with us. Till next week, if his Father's will. Maranatha. Yahushua's coming back again. Hallelujah.